this is a critical issue with regards to the shamanic transformation, is that people go through these terrible, terrible experiences, often drug-induced, by the way, with regards to the shaman. They usually use psychedelic chemicals of one form or another, often mushrooms, but they've come up with some very strange concoctions like ayahuasca down in the Amazon. And ayahuasca is an amazing substance. It's made out of the bark of one thing and another plant whose name I don't remember, that hardly even grow in the same place and that have to be cooked together in a special way. And no one has any idea how the damn Amazonians figured that out. It looks impossible. And if you ask them, they say, well, the plants told us how to do it, which, you know, Western people don't find very helpful. But the shamans are perfectly happy with that description. And ayahuasca takes them apart. And it does that in part because it affects the serotonergic system very, very powerfully, like all psychedelics do. And it transports them to another world. And that's how they interpret it. And what we know about psychedelics, you could put in a thimble and then throw the thimble away. We know nothing about psychedelics. There's new experiments going on at Johns Hopkins, for example, with psilocybin, which is part of this active chemical in magic mushrooms. Same structure, basically, as LSD and mescaline. And all the real psychedelics have basically the same structure, except the one that's derived from Amanita muscaria, which is called muscarinic acid. And it's its own weird thing that no one knows anything about. Anyways, they have profound neurochemical effects in very small doses. And the research group at Johns Hopkins has given psilocybin to research subjects, you know, purified psilocybin, because they started the new experimentation with psychedelics, and that's been banned for like 40 years, because psychedelics were so terrifying to our culture that we just put them away. It's like, whoa, no, we're not going there. And so even from a research perspective, and even though some of the psychedelics look very promising for the treatment of disorders like alcoholism, they recently used psilocybin to help people stop smoking down at Johns Hopkins. And I think they had an 80% success rate, which is just, like, that's just absolutely mind-boggling. And so, but if you give people psilocybin and they have a mystical experience, which is very common among people who take these sorts of chemicals, then their personality transforms permanently, such that 1 year later, they're one standard deviation higher in openness. And openness is the creativity dimension. And that seems to be a permanent transformation. And so that's really remarkable. And about 80% of the people who undergo the Johns Hopkins experiments report that the experience is like one of the two or three most important things they've ever, that's ever happened to them. And so, well, that's something, you know, it's like, and then there's this guy named Rick Strassman down at, I think he was at the University of Texas, and he did experimentation with DMT. And DMT, dimethyltryptamine, if I remember correctly, is the active ingredient in ayahuasca. And you produce it in your brain, and it's in plants. It's like a very common chemical. But DMT is a weird hallucinogen because it has an extraordinarily short mechanism of action. It's like, and people who take it report that they're blasted out of their body, like out of a cannon, and then they go out somewhere and encounter beings of various sorts, and then 10 minutes later, they're back. And virtually everyone reports that, which is really strange. And so Strassman was giving people DMT intravenously so that the trip would last longer. This was all you know, NIH-funded experimentation, all cleared with the relevant ethics boards, all conducted within the last 10 years. And he basically quit doing it because he was a pretty straight scientist. You know, he was measuring heart rate and pulse and all that sort of thing, trying to look at the physiology. And then the people he was giving these chemicals to kept coming back and telling him these crazy stories. And, it was too much for him, you know, and no wonder, you know, because they all said the same thing. And he'd say, well, that was a dream. And they'd say, no, and it was the most real thing that ever happened to me. And he'd say, well, you know, it's an archetypal experience. And they'd say, no, that was no archetypal experience. I went somewhere else and I saw things and I'm back and, like, I don't care what you think. And, like, who the hell knows, right? Because it's all subjective. But the weird thing about it is that everyone's reporting the same thing. How the hell do you account for that? And then the shaman, you know, when they take these psychedelic chemicals, they basically say the same thing. They say, well, first of all, it more or less killed me. That's this. You know, I dissolved to a skeleton, and then I climbed the tree that unites heaven and earth, and I went into the realm of the gods, and they gave me some information, and I'm back. It's like, okay, well, you know, we don't really know what to make of that. And certainly that's what Eliade describes when he describes the shamanic procession, not the shamanic initiation. And You know, there's dissolution to a skeleton first, and then like a death, a symbolic death, or experienced as an actual death, and then bang, up into the realm of the gods, and then they come back. It's a very old idea. I mean, that's a medieval representation of the tunnel that people travel through at the end of their life to, you know, to find the light, which is a very common near-death experience report, and people don't have any idea what the hell to do with those reports, except say, well, it's the paroxysms of the dying brain, which you'd expect to be a hell of a lot more random, in my opinion. And the idea is there's a rebirth after that. And you know, here, this is the Scandinavian representation of that tree that unites earth with heaven. And so there's the Scandinavian representation. It has a snakes down here eating it. And then that's the Amazonian representation. It's like, how the hell do you account for that? I mean, those pictures are so similar that it's beyond belief. Well, you know, we lived in trees for a long time. A long, 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 long time. Millions of years. And there were lots of snakes around them. And so the idea that reality is a tree that's surrounded by a snake is, that's in us, man. It's down there. It's deep. And there's something about it that's true. Now, not true like we normally think of truth, but truth, true in an entirely different manner. So, and all that's pretty damn strange. We'll stop with this. My son drew this when he was 7 years old. It blew me away, man. I thought it was so cool, so I had it laminated. And so, here is what it is. On the right-hand side, that's order. It's like the yin-yang thing. That's order. Left side, chaos. Right? And those are all mushroom houses, which I thought was amazing. And then, there's this river that runs right down the middle, like the line for order and chaos. And then there's this tree that goes up to heaven, and that's heaven up there. It's like, there's St. Peter, there's the pearly gates, there's the clouds. It's like, he never went to church, you know. It's like, what the hell? And then there's a little bug there that goes up and down from heaven to earth, and that was him. And I thought, he had a very organized psyche, that kid. He was a very, very stable kid, and still is. And he drew that, and I thought, Jesus, that's just bloody well unbelievable. And I still think that when I look at it. And that's a great example of an archetype. And so we'll see you Tuesday.